वेलकम माय डियर स्टूडेंट्स ऑफ क्लास 10A and 10B टू माय हिस्ट्री एंड सिविक्स क्लास। इन टुडेज हिस्ट्री क्लास द चैप्टर आई एम गोइंग टू टीच यू इज चैप्टर नंबर 2, टॉपिक बिगिनिंग ऑफ इंडियन नेशनलिज्म। लुक एट इट, चैप्टर नंबर 2, टॉपिक बिगिनिंग ऑफ इंडियन नेशनलिज्म। Indian nationalism, the points which I am going to explain. Point number 1, as mentioned here, economic exploitation. Second one, rediscovering the glorious past of India. Third point, nationalistic aspirations. Fourth point, administrative management. And fifth point, role of the intellectuals. Now first one, economic exploitation. You know, the British undoubtedly exploited Indian money. They undoubtedly drained Indian wealth in order to utilize it in their own purpose. In order to serve their own purpose, the British drained Indian wealth to their own country, England. The British, you know, set up a number of factories and industries in England. So the finished products from such factories flooded Indian large market. That's why they needed the large market of India. That's why they started, you know, supplying British goods to our market, to Indian market. And at the same time, they started, importing Indian raw materials in order to meet the demand of their factories and industries in England. So this was nothing but a clear economic exploitation practiced by the British. It was duly analyzed by one eminent writer, eminent professor of Elphinstone College, Bombay, Dadabhai Nowroji, in his famous book, Poverty and Un-British Rule in India. In that very book, Dadabhai Nowroji criticized the repressive policy of the British government. He drew attention the members of British Parliament about the miserable conditions of the Indians in India. He tried to bring their attention in a sense that the Indians, who were supposed to be given their rights, minimum rights, the British did not have any interest of it. The Britishers remained busy, the British government remained busy in safeguarding their own interests. Hence, Poverty and Un-British Rule in India, which was written by Dadabhai Nowroji, was accepted cordially by not only the Indians but other countries of Asia, Europe. In that famous book, Dadabhai Nowroji gave his remarks regarding the drain of wealth, the drain theory of the British. How did they establish it? How were the Britishers benefited with that theory? Each and every point is thoroughly discussed in this famous book, Poverty and Un-British Rule in India. Second point,
discovering the glorious past of India, rediscovering the glorious past of India, rediscovering. What is the meaning of rediscovering the glorious past of India, my dear students? You know, during the late 18th and early 19th century, during the last half of the 18th and first half of 19th century in India, the thoughts and ideas of the people of India were totally changed due to the concept of Renaissance. The wave of Renaissance also reached India. The modern education encouraged Indian people. They were inspired by the ideas of French Revolution, American Revolution. That wave of inspiration encouraged Indian revolutionaries and their nationalistic aspirations. A number of Indian places from where the glorious past of India were rediscovered. One of the most eminent person from the archaeologists, British archaeologist Cunningham, Sir Alexander Cunningham, prepared many reports on it, according to which later on, two eminent archaeologists from India, number one, Dayaram Sahni, and number two, R.D. Banerjee, discovered the Indus Valley Civilization, Harappa and Mohenjo-daro Civilization, respectively. In the year 1921, first half and second half of the 1920. The British wanted to rediscover, you know, not only the British but also some Indian educated people. They inspired some Britishers, some educationists to rediscover Indian past glory and image. But the British government had no interest of it, because British government realized that discovering of the past and glorious image of the Indians might become a cause of confrontation between the British and the Indian educated people. That's why they did not encourage it. But Sir Alexander Cunningham visited various historical places of India, like, you know, Sarnath, Sanchi, and so many important places. And on the other hand, some scholars also encourage Sir Alexander Cunningham to find out the past glory, past history of India. Scholars like James Prinsep, he disappeared Kharosthi and Brahmi, the ancient scripts of India. Under such circumstances, the effect of the Renaissance reached India, and it was seen in the field of art, culture, literature, and the great personalities of India. From middle class families, they left their impressions on it. Indian educationists, intellectuals, they reflected their feelings, they reflected their ideals through their writings. It was Bankim Chandra Chattopadhyay wrote the famous book Anandamath. That very book had become a symbol of Indian revolutionary and Indian nationalist movement. It was Rabindranath Tagore who wrote Gora, that famous novel, encouraged Indian national movement and nationalist leaders. The themes of both the two novels, Anandamath and Gora, encouraged Indian nationalistic aspirations. The feeling of nationhood
throughout the subcontinent, encourage not only Indian revolutionaries but also other communities of India. They came together to share their experiences of the British Raj. Their anger and antagonism obstructed the way of development for the Britishers. The Britishers remained busy in safeguarding their own interests. They did not have any interest for the Indian people and their growth and development. That's why they openly criticized the British policy of repression. They needed a forum that would allow this for the foreign rulers. And apart from this, this gave rise to the various organizations. A number of Indian nationalists started organizing a number of seminars. They started attending meetings. They made public opinion against the British government. They tried to bring attention to the Indian nationalist movement. They tried to bring attention of the government towards the repressive policies and its bad effect among the Indians. But the British government did not take any initiative to stop passing this kind of unjust laws and wrong policies and theories. That's why, my dear students, Indian intellectuals, they encourage Indian nationalistic aspirations among the Indians. It was Anandamath, the famous novel written by Bankim Chandra Chattopadhyay. It was Gora, another famous novel written by Rabindranath Tagore, encourage Indian national movement, encourage Indian nationalist leaders. They all were inspired by the ideals of the characters created by Bankim Chandra Chattopadhyay in Anandamath and Rabindranath Tagore in Gora. On being inspired by them, they strengthened Indian national movement against the British rule. They forced the British to bring certain changes in the structure of their administration. They not only criticized the British and their policies, but also motivated Indians to be the member of such political organizations which were set up for not only making public opinion, but also to create nation-wise resentment among the Indians. A number of Indian cities were traveled by Surendranath Banerjee. He visited Lucknow, Delhi, Bombay, and attended a number of meetings, seminars, and made public opinion. He delivered good speeches among the people, before the people. People accepted him to be their leader. People accepted him to be an all-Indian leader of the Congress. He belonged to early nationalist group, Adattu, Dadabhai Nauroji and Gopal Krishna Gokhale also left no stone unturned to draw the attention of the British government regarding the miserable conditions of the Indians and its the repressive policies framed by the British. But the British government did not have any sympathy for Indian people.
Now, administrative management. Next point, the administrative management. What is it? The administrative management. Queen Victoria
proclaimed that the injustice, whatever was done to Indian people, that act of misgovernance practiced by the British could be immediately stopped. Queen Victoria openly declared that no repressive policy could be passed which might harm the sentiments of the Indians. On the contrary, the British government would pass many good policies which would protect the interests of the Indians and subsequently would bring prosperity among the Indian people. There would be no grievance among the Indians against the British. That's why he initially passed many good policies, gave many concessions to the Indians. But after a few years later, what he promised before the people of India, these were of no use to them, because the British started adopting the same repressive policies in order to safeguard their own interests in India. For example, Indian intellectuals who received Western education, they were recruited in the British administration, but they were paid poorly. On the contrary, the British officials were paid fat salary. Indians realized it and raised question against that injustice done to them. Lowering of the entry age for the ICS exam from 21 to 19 was a direct attempt against the Indians, because many Indians had capability to compete ICS exam along with ICS exam along with the British students. But Indian people, on being administrative official after having passed ICS exam, might become a cause of, you know, tension for the Britishers. The British realized it later. Why? Because many Indians who passed the ICS exam, on being appointed in the administration, they left British jobs and joined Indian National Movement. Why? Because they realized that the low amount of salary and fat salary for the Britishers could become a cause of difference between the British and the Indians. Since the Britishers directly were harming the sentiments of Indian people, they must leave the job, because they did not come from any poor family. They belonged to rich families who went to abroad and passed the ICS exam successfully. They all were from rich families of Bengal. So many of them left British jobs and joined Indian National Movement. And it is due to that reason the Britishers were scared of the motive of the Indian people. The Indian educated people, according to the Britishers, were very ferocious. The Britishers were afraid of the motives of the Indian people, Indian educated people, lest they might leave the job and join Indian National Movement. Then A large section of Indian educated people would become a part of Indian national movement. They would go against the British government and would criticize the British from time to time and create an atmosphere the Britishers would be unable to run their administration smoothly in India. That's why, my dear students, the Britishers decided to lower the age from 21 to 19 so that Indian people must not take part the ICS exam. How funny is it? Is it? The British did it with a view to stop participating ICS exam by the Indian people, Indian educated people. That's why they followed that system. They adopted the policy of discrimination. And only for that reason, my dear students, the British also passed the Vernacular Place Act in the year 1878. The Vernacular Place Act was not allowed to print anything or any articles that would cause trouble for the government, British government. This bond was not required by the English press. Thus, this censorship of the press annoyed most Indians, as they felt it was really motivating. It was racially motivated. The Arms Act of 1878 was very, very discriminating. It stated that Indians would never be able to carry any weapons without being consented by the British, but only the Britishers. The Britishers need not have to take any permission from the government to carry any revolver or any guns with them, but only the Indians. This act of injustice, this act of discrimination between the British and Indian people created nationwide dissatisfaction among the Indians. This constant humiliation and ill treatment by the British minority prompted many, many people to take up arms against the British. It was due to the effort of Indian revolutionaries. It was due to the effort of, Hardwal, Lala Hardwal, Indian revolutionaries were given many, many arms. The Gadhar Party, which was established by Lala Hardwal in America, arms were supplied from there for the Indian revolutionaries. As a result, Indian revolutionaries were inspired by Lala Hardwal and his secret organization, Gadhar Party. It is due to that reason, my dear students, most of the Indian people, they all strongly supported Indian revolutionaries so that they must fight against the British rule, against the British unjust discriminative laws, British unjust policies, and must make our country free from British control. Up to this, my dear students, thank you.